Aloha. And welcome to What's Bugging You, brought to you by Hawaii's leader in pest control and the first company in Hawaii to earn the National Quality Pro Certification, Sandwich Isle Pest Solutions. Now, here's the host of our show, Mike Buck.
Somebody actually asked me if that was me singing. Nah, it's a clever recording. Sounds like me in the shower. And I don't like singing about cockroaches, but you know, here in Hawaii, sometimes we have to do that. Welcome aboard. It's What's Bugging You, the show brought to you by Sandwich Isle Pest Solutions and Michael Botha. Michael Botha has been in the business for a long time, and it's sort of ironic if you learned before. Michael's from South Africa, and ironically, around the other side of the globe, South Africa and Hawaii are a lot. So he brought, you know, like decades between him and his dad and his grandpa before that, decades of experience here to Hawaii. And thank goodness, because we really need you. How you doing?
Yeah, good. Thank you, Mike.
Thank goodness you arrived, you know.
Well, thank you.
We've noticed a couple of things since we started doing this program. People, they really want to be aware, and they want to be able to, you know, do things to help in pest control, but they want it to be safe. And that's one of the things we're going to learn today. A lot of things will kill bugs, right? But they also are not very good for pets or people.
Yeah, you know, today most of the products that are available are very safe. Mm-hmm. Almost everything that's used by professional pest control operators today is general use pesticides, not restricted use. Mm-hmm. And so they're very safe to use around the home. The biggest issues typically come when people find old pesticides that have been kept in the garage.
Sure.
And then they use them. Or maybe it was an agricultural type pesticide, and then they use it themselves. That's actually where the biggest problems are.
You know what I think is fascinating? If you found a can of tuna in your closet that said, you know, September 07, you'd throw it away. But paint or bug killer, yeah, it's still good.
Maybe it's all the pesticides, because I don't eat it. So my wife always wonders why I eat all the old food. But I hate throwing food away.
By the way, I do too, and I want to tell you something, and I've learned this from my dear friend Dick Grimm of the Hawaii Food Bank. That there's a big margin of error on that expiration date for food. Families, if you've got a can of tuna or something that's a couple of months out, it's okay. It's not going
to
hurt you.
Well, Mike, let me talk to you about food real quick. There's a statistic that came out recently. And the National Pest Management Association does all kinds of research. Mm-hmm. They have an arm called PPMA. Basically what they do is they're continually doing research on pest management and how it's impacting the environment. Mm-hmm. And so on. And recently in the U.S., they identified that over 50% of the crops that we produce in the U.S. every year would be completely destroyed if it weren't for pest control.
Boy, I 100% believe that.
50%. So think about that.
I 100% believe that.
So think how much food we produce. We're one of the largest food producing nations in the world.
I know that there's a huge ongoing controversy about GMOs and about a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
But when you start talking about pesticides, from what I understand, there would be some crops, if it weren't for pesticides and chemical control, they just wouldn't make it. They'd just go away.
That's absolutely right. In fact, like, just think about rodent control. Just take rodents for an example. Mm-hmm. Rodents eat and continually pee and poop out all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So when they're feeding on something, let's say it's some type of grain, a 100-pound bag of grain, and they're feeding on just one grain, but they're peeing and pooping the whole time, all of that grain is destroyed. And then they have all kinds of diseases that they carry. Mm-hmm. And that's just one pest. So if it wasn't for pest control, literally we would starve. And this entire world would be starving if it weren't for pest control. And something to consider too is 11% of the average U.S. disposable income is spent on food. 11%, okay, which is not much. When you consider that in Japan, it's 19.9%.
20%.
And in China, 53%.
Half. Gee, right. More than half.
And you know why? Because they don't have very good sanitation.
Yeah.
And so they can't keep things long. Like, think about your pantry at home.
Yep.
We were just talking about throwing things away that have been there so long. They haven't been destroyed by pests, but they get old, right?
Yeah.
And if you never had pest control, a lot of that would be destroyed by pests. You'd have Indian meal moths and all kinds of things inside there.
Boy, we could do an hour standing on our ear on that one. And I'm sure that, you know, given the opportunity, we will going along. But let's get into what we're going to do this week. First of all, the title of our show today is Swarming Termites, and boy, are they. And also some other things that we're going to talk about, scale, pest control industry, and how to prepare your home for a fumigation, all very key things. But first of all, I called Michael earlier in the week, and he'd already heard about this. We have a plant here, Michael, as everybody knows. It's called Lauhala. It's used for basket weaving and making hats and making sleeping mats and all kinds of things. And I guess we take it for granted, but they're kind of threatened right now. What do you know? What have you learned about this new tiny little pest that seems to be doing so much damage?
Well, I personally love those trees. I have four of them at my house that I planted, and they're really easy to plant. Yeah. You can actually break off one of the stems
and just stick it right
just stick it in the ground.
I did that too.
Yeah, I did that four years ago. Yeah. Now I've got three or four 40-foot trees, and they're absolutely beautiful trees. Really strong root system. They're called the pandanus as well. That's another name, or the walking tree, because they have those giant roots that kind of hang down from the trunk and then go into the ground.
And look at it in the past of now at all the things that are made out of bamboo, right? And it used to be in the past the pandanus tree that was that was everything. It was blankets, it was clothing, it was bowls. It was hats,
isn't that what
everything.
They made the sleeping mats out of?
Absolutely.
The ancient Hawaiians. I think it's and they made all kinds of jewelry and the baskets. That's it. Yeah.
The
sails for the sailing canoes were made out of that.
Absolutely.
But it's amazing. So
help! What's happening to this?
Okay,
stuff?
So here's what I know about the situation. Basically, there's a small scale. It's a little scale with a black dot and a white ring around it. Now, scale is quite common. You can look at almost any plant, including the ones in your parking lot downstairs, Mike. Yeah. They have scale on them.
I was going to say scale to me means I weigh 220. What is a scale? What does that
mean? Have two different types of scale. You have a hard scale and a soft scale, and basically it looks just like a little scale, like a saucer line on its
just
side.
Just hanging on the leaf.
And it typically is on the underside of the leaves.
Underneath.
And they have sucking mouth parts, so they basically damage the plants because they eat into the plant and then they suck the juices out of the plant.
Right.
In so doing, they can also transmit different types of viruses, bacteria, or diseases.
Is white fly a scale, or is that something different?
That's different. So that's actually a diptera, it's a fly. Okay. But often you'll have white fly and scale on the exact same leaf.
Okay, that's what I'm thinking.
So sometimes scale's different colors, too. You have different color scales. Some of it's white. Anyway, so as far as this scale is concerned, what it does is it can actually kill the plant, but it really damages the leaves. That's the big issue.
And of course, hollow the leaf is the
that's the whole thing, right? That's
the value
that's
of the
what
plant.
People need.
Right. Yeah.
And so, not only is it useful, but it's an ornamental. Like in my case, if we have them as an ornamental plant because it's a beautiful tree, it's a fast-growing tree, a very sturdy tree. So, what happens is the leaves start to yellow and they start to die off, which makes them undesirable. And they're actually big trees, so it's difficult to cut all those leaves down. The other part is that even if you cut the leaves off, it's been proven that these scale will live up to 6 days on a leaf that's been cut off a tree. So think
You've
about that.
You've warned us before. If you do this cutting, you got to get it
get
bagged,
off your
you
property.
Get it off your property.
Yeah, I would take it to the green waste dump
immediately.
Same thing with whitefly, soft scale, hard scale, any type of plant sucking insect. The best thing to do is when you cut it down, get it off your property. Because
a lot of people don't put it in your green can, especially if it's going to be 10 days before it gets picked up.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so. But herein lies the problem. This is how it can be spread. So right now, it first started in Hana, in Maui. Then it was discovered in Molokai. And now it's in Haleiwa.
This is the Hala scale.
The Hala scale.
Yeah.
And so you have to ask yourself, how does a creature that doesn't move around much get around all over the place? Well, it's because it's been transported by
thanks
humans.
Thanks to us.
Yeah, exactly. They can't walk from one location to the next.
Oh, boy.
Because they don't move too quick. Anyway, so that is the problem. Now, in the report that I read in the news, they talked about the difficulty in controlling this particular scale. Often scales are controlled by using simple things like soapy water.
Sure.
Soap is a surfactant, so you spray it upon the leaf. It spreads over the leaf and suffocates the plant, or suffocates the insect that's feeding on the plant. And it's a spreader, too, so it actually clings to the underside of the leaves where these scale live.
And by the way, let me ask you this. I know that a lot of our detergents, a lot of our soaps now are biodegradable. So
that's right.
There's it's not a lot of danger spraying that on the plant because won't you just water it down and go away?
Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah. So some of the green alternatives are soap and water, although they say that it doesn't work very well on this particular scale. But for general use, I find soap and water to be very useful.
Right.
The other thing is using a fine oil. You can actually get a fine grade oil, a plant oil, that's designed to be applied to plants. Certain oils can't be applied to plants because they're phytotoxic. They'll reflect the sun and cause the plant to get sunburned. But you do get specific light oils that can be mixed with water in some cases and sprayed onto plants, and that also is a surfactant that goes over the leaf and suffocates them.
Okay, now you got my curiosity to speak. Where would you acquire that oil? Where would you get it?
You know, we have a restricted use permit, so we buy everything through a distributor that sells pesticides. So I'm not sure if you can buy that from without a license, but you surely can buy this at some of the larger hardware stores and landscaping stores. So you can definitely get all that type of thing in the landscaping section. But I don't believe that these scale are bulletproof. My experience has been that if you use a systemic pesticide, so a systemic pesticide, for example, imidacloprid is an active ingredient that is commonly used for all kinds of plant-sucking insects. Mm-hmm. What you do is you apply it to the root area below the plant, and the plants then take up the active ingredient.
Oh, I get it.
Imidacloprid.
Like water. Just,
they take
just
it up.
Absorbing it.
It doesn't affect the plant in any negative way.
Mm-hmm.
But any insect that eats the plant will die.
Yeah.
And so that's how you have very effective control of all sorts of scale, white fly, sooty mold, mealybugs, everything.
Mm-hmm.
We have very good control with that. So in my opinion, if I had these things, I would treat it with imidacloprid, and I'll do a systemic treatment and possibly a surface treatment too. And I'm quite sure that would take care of the problem.
All right. You heard it here first. Now, you know, we often talk about this last week and the week before, and I guess it's the time of the year or whatever. We're starting to get a little more humidity and the summer's coming. You say that, you know, sometimes many weeks can go by, you don't hear much in many problems about rodents, but they're back in the news again. And I'm not quite sure why. What do you find?
Well, Mike, I think that the big issue with rodents is fruit. There is an incredible abundance of fruit on the ground right now. If you drive past any house that has a lychee tree, you'll see that the lychees are so heavy this year that in many areas I've seen lychee trees where all the lychees are on the ground and they're still on the tree because the branches are so heavy with lychees.
Somebody better send that memo to my lily koi because I haven't seen much fruit yet. I'm still waiting. You know,
so we had mangoes. Now we got all the lychees,
so
papayas.
That is the food of choice for rodents.
Well, we're dealing mostly with roof rats in Hawaii, and roof rats love fruit.
Mm-hmm.
And so the more fruit, what I've seen over the 20 years that I've been involved in pest management in Hawaii, is that when you have a high abundance of fruit, you have a high abundance of roof rats.
Yeah, but
and
you're,
so that it kind of they parallel each other. But if we could just go back for a second and go back to that Hala scale issue, one thing I would like to do is point out that there is a phone number people can call.
All right.
And it's the Department of Agriculture actually has a number, which is 643-PEST. And if you call that number, 643-PEST, P-E-S-T, if you have any issues or questions and you think your hula tree might be suffering from the scale, go ahead and call that number because they staffed and we have some professionals out there that might be able to help you. And so I actually called that number to see if it worked and to see if someone would answer the phone. And I was quite surprised to find that somebody quickly answered the phone. His name was Craig. And he took my call and I explained that I was just actually testing the number because I wanted to make sure before I mentioned it, it actually was going to be answered. But the number
works. So keep that, write that down. It's 643-PEST. That's P-E-S-T. And if you're alphabet challenge, I'll give you the actual numbers a little later on in the show. I'll go do that for you. Okay, so hopefully, and don't the article would have led people to believe that we were doomed.
That's what I think is wrong about that article. Is let me tell you something: there is not a single pest that can't be controlled with integrated pest management. And so
not a single pest.
You bring on the pest, and I can tell you that how it'll be solved. So the good thing about pest management today is that the technology, the materials, the active ingredients, the protocols and procedures that are in place are just incredible. And that's why in America we have such good control of our pests, because this is an incredible industry. And so there's not a pest challenge that cannot be resolved.
Yeah, that's good to know. And we're going to get into that a little more. It's part of the mantra of Sandwich Isle Pest Solutions, folks. And that's at sandwichisle.com. If they're going to fix this. I mean, they keep coming back until they get the job done. And by the way, just so I did the math for you, 643-PEST is 643-7378. That's 643-7378. Okay, here comes the summer, and here comes, you talked a little bit about rodents. We've got a little bit more on that, maybe species. But what about these termites? They are everywhere.
Holy moly. I'll tell you what. Usually in preparation for our meeting today, Mike, I go back and I look at our lead report, and I talk to all of our estimators out there. And so I get a general sense of the calls coming in from across the state.
Mm-hmm.
So we provide services on the other islands, and we get calls from them too. And I'll tell you, termites are everywhere.
Yeah,
I honestly don't recall seeing as strong swarms as we had last week. Last weekend, the Memorial Day weekend, we had three nights in a row of swarms where you couldn't see the lights. So the street lights in the, on
That's
the north
scary.
Shore of Oahu yeah. were like clouds. Yeah. You know, you could just see like this faint light behind all the termites. And so termites are swarming more than I have seen in many, many years. You know, think back 20 years ago how the termite swarms were. We went through a stage where we, you know, for the last, I would say, maybe 15 years ago to about 5 years ago, that 10-year period, the swarms really diminished. And we're not sure what happened. A lot mm-hmm. of people, and it was actually a national thing. It wasn't just in Hawaii. But the swarms that we've seen recently are massive.
You know, I've actually learned something else, gang, and this goes for those of you that are, you know, fans of some of our other shows. I learned from Atlas Construction, who are doing an awful lot of, you know, remodels right now with people's tax returns, and they're thinking about additional dwelling units and all of these things, that they're expecting in almost all of these places where they're doing remodels to encounter termite damage during the construction process that'll need to be addressed.
Well, I think it goes down to the age of the home.
Yeah.
If you consider that termites swarm year-round almost, mm-hmm. At least 10 months of the year in Hawaii, which means that you have kings and queens of termites constantly targeting your house and landing on them. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter what you do. You're going to have termites. That'll, yeah. You can treat it, 10 fumigate it tomorrow, and the next day you'll have termites that can swarm and, mm-hmm. and land on your house. There's nothing you can do to protect yourself against that except have an annual inspection. So when you consider the average age of a home in Hawaii, mm-hmm. which I don't know what it is, but I'm guessing it must be over 40 years.
I would say, yeah, at least 40. Maybe.
Yeah,
and,
probably.
And I think we're getting up in like Aina Haina Kaimuki and lots of places like that in the 50s, 60s, and 70s.
So think about how many nights they've been exposed in their lifetime, right, to termite swarm. So that's the reason why. And so, you know, we always say
that. What I'm saying is you said something that's very accurate. The amount of damage that they do is measurable, because when you're going to do this remodel and you have to spend $5,000, $6,000, $10,000 in remedial work on wood, that really is a harsh reality of what dollars termites cost all of our families.
That's exactly right. And that's how I always tell people, get your house inspected annually. Get a mm-hmm. professional. Don't try and do it yourself. I have one of my guys inspect my house because I don't have the time to do it properly. And so get someone who has the time to do it properly and who's thorough and is going to go to all the dark, difficult to reach areas that you don't want to go, right? And get it done annually, because that way when you – what he's going to find is he's going to find termites somewhere. And he can spot treat them, do a full treatment. And, you know, if it's subterranean termites, for example, they eat 4 pounds of wood a day.
Yeah.
Their colony, right? So imagine if you don't see it for 2 years.
We just keep saying, do the math. I mean, what is the doorway? A doorway is 10 pounds. That's 2.5 days food. And that's gone. No door.
Now imagine 10 years of not inspecting your crawl space.
Yeah.
What it does to your beams.
Incidentally, though, from what the materials that you sent me said that we're not having a duplicative effort seemingly on the mainland for some reason.
No, that's another interesting thing.
That's very strange, isn't it?
So the National Pest Management Association has a forum. It's called the Swarming Termite Forum, and I'm on that forum. So every week we all post our swarm reports from the various different states. And the Northeast is actually having pretty strong swarms, but mm-hmm. a lot of the other termite states, California, all of the southern states and most of the eastern seaboard, they're actually having pretty slow swarms. So up in the Northeast, they're having good swarms, but the rest of the country is pretty slow right now, uncharacteristically so.
Yeah, and we could go neighborhood by neighborhood, but I don't want to scare anybody.
Yeah,
I mean, you know, that'll come soon enough. What about finally, before we move on to some other stuff, you said that there are, just out of curiosity, about 7 kinds of termites here.
There are 7 different species in Hawaii.
What about in total, you know, worldwide?
Wow, that's a good question. I don't know. Isoptera, which is the order of insects that termites mm-hmm. are under, is not a very, very large order compared to, say, Hymenoptera, which is ants, bees, wasps, where there's just gazillions of ants.
The only reason I bring it up
not
is
that many.
I'm guessing that we here in Hawaii have a pretty big slice of them for whatever reason. Introduced or whatever.
Absolutely. I would say we have more termites than any other state. Perhaps Florida might have more than us, just because they've got so much, their proximity to the Bahamas and the Caribbean mm-hmm. and South America and Central America. So they may have more than us, but it's very unusual to have 7 different species of termites.
Okay, when you start talking about people that are going to come out and do a bar inspection, it reminds me to ask you about people, because I know that you're in the people business. You're constantly recruiting. You interview somebody, every day at Sandwich Isle. You've just bought a couple of new trucks, which means you probably need a couple of new people.
Yep. You know, it's an ongoing process, Mike. We've hired 8 people in the last 30 days, and that's not to replace people. That's to fit new jobs. And so we're trying to expand not only on Oahu, but on the outer island. So we actually have a number of positions open. We've got, I think, 2 pest control specialist trainee jobs on Oahu. We have a customer service representative job on Oahu. Mm-hmm. And then we have a pest control service technician job. These are all new hires for each of the other islands. So Maui, Kauai, Hilo, and Kona.
What sort of presence do you have there with regards to being able to do full service?
We don't offer tent fumigation at this point in time on the outer islands.
Yeah.
And we have in the past.
I have an idea.
What's that?
Tell them all about orange oil.
There you go. Well, do you remember what happened with the ferry, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay,
yeah.
So the ferry made life pretty easy for us. We had a much bigger presence on some of the outer islands, and we kind of scaled back the fumigation only because of the difficulty. And this is a great story, actually, when you think about it. So the big island is lava rock on the Kona side, which is where we were based.
Yeah.
And where we did most of our fumigation on the Big Island was on Kona. The issue with fumigating in Kona is that for fumigation to work, you have to have a perfect seal. That means that you have a very high quality tent that encapsulates the structure above ground and doesn't allow any gas to come out.
Gotcha.
Then you join those tents together with what we call seams, and you make sure your seams are airtight so no gas comes out the seams. So then you have the last one, which is the ground seal, and that is where you have the tent that touches the ground.
Okay.
Now, on the Big Island, you have so much lava. And so what happens is you have sometimes lava tubes underneath the house.
All those big holes.
It just sucks all your gas out. So,
oh boy.
So we wondered why we're having such difficulty with our fumigations. Everything was going right. We were using more materials than we should have been, and we're having some failures. So we started doing there's a device called a fumiscope, which measures the concentration of gas during a fumigation. And what we found absolutely shocked us. All of the gas was going straight out into the ground.
Jeez.
Because it's all that really hard to seal rough lava ground, and then all the tubes and things and cracks underneath it. And so we decided we're going to get out of the fumigation business on the Big Island because of that, because it was just too challenging.
Just a real quickie for you boaters like me, if you have a boat in the water, I've seen Michael's company, because boats, you know, termites get into boats, boy, they cause some incredible damage. You can actually fumigate a boat in the water by encapsulating it with a tent that goes down to the ocean and seals that boat up like it's in a drum.
That's right. You know, we do a lot of tent fumigation, of course, and of structures, and sometimes people, if they have a trailer or boat, will just park it in the garage or nearby. We can cover that whilst they're in the house, and that's a good way to go if it's a trailer or boat. But there's 2 ways of doing a boat. Number one, you can treat a boat in the water. So water is a perfect seal.
Of course.
Gas does not go through liquid.
Yep.
So when you put the tarpaulin down into the ground, as opposed to the Big Island where you've got lava rock that sucks all the gas out, now you have water which contains it all.
It keeps it,
it's a perfect seal. Yeah. So fumigating a boat in the water, while technically challenging, is actually a very good way of doing it because you have a perfect seal.
I know a guy that did it with you years ago. He had termites in his stringers and the boat was getting soft. And they went in and they were able to, number one, kill the termites, and then after that inject resin and other things into that beam to strengthen it again.
Well, Mike, you know how the plumber's toilet never leaks, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Well,
your boat. Let's talk about your boat.
Over 14 years, I had a wooden boat.
Yeah.
It was a 42-foot boat. And over 14 years, I had termites 3 times. And I was in Coalina Marina, in the middle of the marina, not near the shore.
Yeah, not near
the shore. And I know that every single job was a perfect job because I personally monitored every single job. And I know that we achieved our dosage goals. So there's no doubt that it was a reinfestation. But 3 separate times over 14 years. So, amazing.
What we're going to do here is take a fast break, and when we come back, boy, are we going to light them up. We're going to talk about the swarming termites and how you can protect your home right after this.
At Sandwich Isle, we believe the best way to protect your home from unwanted pests is not through control, but through prevention. Pest prevention is a unique concept perfected by Sandwich Isle in 1997. Over the years, we have continued to improve our service effectiveness with the many technological advances in our industry. Today, Sandwich Isle's pest prevention is recognized as one of the most environmentally responsible and effective approaches in the industry. Expect more and get it with Sandwich Isle Pest Solutions. Simply put, if we cannot solve your pest problem, we'll keep coming back at no additional cost until you are completely satisfied. And if, for any reason, you're not completely satisfied, we'll refund your last payment, no questions asked. Remember, pests can no longer be considered simply a nuisance. Keeping pests out of your home is critical for your health and the health of your family. Don't settle for anything less than the best. That's Sandwich Isle Pest Solutions. Expect more and get it.
Okay, you know, it is unbelievable. And let me tell you something. While Michael's left the building for a moment, I got to tell you that not only am I proud to be the facilitator of this program, What's Bugging You, for him, but for the last 20 years, he supported our program in any number of ways. And he has been my personal. We have the Central Con system at our house. It's unbelievable. And what he does at Sandwich Isle is way above and beyond the call. As a matter of fact, they'll keep coming back until they get it right. And that's what that fumigation process is. Millions and millions of homeowners all over the country are battling with termite infestations every single year. Here in Hawaii, it is absolutely, he often says, there are two types of homes, those that have termites and those that are about to have them. I mean, there's just no getting away from it. Now, he did say earlier in the program that right after you tent your home, it's vulnerable again. But the good news is that all of the termites that came in and were eating this 4 pounds of wood a day are dead. That's what the fumigation does. Now, if the colony would literally have to start all over again. Well, when you get that annual inspection, it doesn't happen overnight. You are able to make things work for yourself, and that's kind of the thing you do. All right, I told you a while ago, those of you that want to get in on that holla trees that are under attack, if you suspect that you have the scale pest in your holla tree, call 643-PEST. That's 643-7378. What they want from you is they want you to call it in, even if you're taking care of the problem yourself. They're trying to do a grid to find out where this stuff is. Okay, now, one more thing I want to tell you. Before Michael gets back into the studio, I want to tell you that if you are so fortunate to be employed by that company, it is literally a growth area. Their business is growing by leaps and bounds, partially because of programs like this, but also because they have a reputation of doing a thorough job. And when they say that, you know, your home is your castle, listen to this.
There's a good chance that your house may be the single largest investment that you ever make. It's also your home. It's where you and your family spend a lot of time. It's more than just a place. There are many types of homes, but for our purposes today, there are really only two types of homes, those that have termites and those that will eventually get termites. That's because there's no such thing as a termite-proof home. Call Sandwich Isle today and schedule your free inspection.
See, I told you, and there's two kinds of homes. And the thing is about Sandwich Isle, the mantra that we hear all the time is you expect more and you get it.
At Sandwich Isle, we're committed to great service. Our trained service specialists will protect your home against damage caused by termites and prevent unwanted and unhealthy pests. We believe that if we tell a customer we're going to do something, we ought to do it. And if we don't do it to their complete satisfaction, they deserve their money back. We believe in total customer satisfaction, which is why when you call Sandwich Isle, you can expect more and get it.
So continuing on with the Sandwich Isle message of the day, expect more and get it. And particularly now that this swarm, he said, is just getting just horrific. But I do also want to blow Michael's horn a little bit more for you. And that is Sandwich Isle Pest Solutions is now recognized in the entire country being 92 out of 100, out of the top 100. And they have done some amazing things in the last couple of years. And as far as the National Pest Management Association Business Profile Survey, the most significant changes are, and this is why I'm saying if you're so lucky to be considered to be an employee, some of the things that happen to you are not only great wages and bonuses based on what you do at Sandwich Isle, but also the real bottom line, and that is the possibility of unlimited growth. And I didn't I told everybody that you had to leave the room for a minute. So I've been bragging about you for a while. I hope you don't mind. But you should, your ears aren't burning. But I did sort of cover the fact that, you know, there are many great opportunities there. And I talked a little bit about something, not to scare people, when you say there's two kinds of homes because we played the ad. Although you said earlier that the day after you're tenting, you know, the termites in the area are going to come back. But the good news is that all the damage that had been done on the entire colony that lives in your property is dead.
That's right.
So if you get on that maintenance, that once a year annual inspection, you're going to be able to keep real big damage at bay.
Absolutely. And all of the services that we provide come with a warranty.
Yeah.
And so should you have additional termite issues, we'll go ahead and take care of
that. Yeah, yeah.
And so the key thing is to be proactive and have an annual, at the very least, the message that needs to get out is, at the very least, have your home inspected by a professional at least one times per year.
Okay, everybody asks a question, though, is, and I know it sort of varies a little bit in locale, even within the state, but how often is the recommended time of tenting? Because I know before it was a long time.
That's a great question. Yeah, so that's actually one of the most frequently asked questions.
Yeah, I'm going to ask it because I'm, you know, mine now, when do I have to do it again?
So here's the answer. The answer is you only ever tent fumigate when you have termites.
Mm-hmm.
You never do it as a prevention.
Gotcha.
So I would say 50% of the people that call us say it's been 5 years, 7 years, whatever, would like to get our house tented. But you know that there's absolutely zero benefit in tenting your home if you don't have live termites because there's no residue left behind. So
with the exception, you come out and you're going to put borate in my ceiling.
We'll do the borate in the attic, but the thing is, you know, I'll do that for a hell of a lot cheaper than tenting the house.
Yeah,
you know?
Of course. Yeah.
So the reality is you don't ever need to tent your house until you've got termites. When you've got termites, then you tent it. The other side is so that's drywood termites. Now, subterranean termites are different. You will have subterranean termites if you don't have ongoing protection. So you have two different strategies. You have either a bait or you have a liquid barrier. Now, both of them work very well, but the liquid barrier does need to be replaced at least every 5 years, and the termite bait needs to be an ongoing program where you're replacing the baits on an ongoing cycle.
Which is like me, like the central gun system. Sure.
So that's what you must have for ground termites.
Okay, scared to death, because we mentioned, and I talked about it when you're out, about swarming. Everybody wants it. All right, this swarming. I can't stop the swarming, but what can I do to help maybe make my house not inviting to them?
So one of the things we've been experimenting with is different color light bulbs.
Mm-hmm.
So yellow light bulbs actually are not attractive to flying insects, including termites.
Hmm.
So if you're at home and termites are swarming, the smart thing to do is turn out your lights because they're attracted to
the light. Sure.
And that means your outside lights too.
Mm-hmm.
So don't leave your outside light on near your kitchen door and turn everything off on the inside because they're all going to come to your house.
They're going to figure a way.
But let's say that you were going away for dinner or something. So you leave at 4 p.m. and you leave your lights on at the house, but, and you can't turn them off because you're not there.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in that case,
get a smartphone like you got.
There you go.
You know, do it mobile. Yeah. But a lot of people can't.
But a yellow light bulb would be ideal in that situation. Then it doesn't matter if it's on.
I heard that one of the biggest draws to these things on a hot summer night is your big screen TV. You know, the LED or the
Exactly. The,
you know,
anything that
bright
emits
light, right?
Anything that emits light or reflects light.
Mm-hmm.
Windows reflect light. You've heard stories about people putting out a pail of water.
I was
going
to say, you put water under the TV, and it's like you have a swimming pool for termites. They say
it's because of the reflection. It's because the light reflects off the water, so they just fly into the reflection. Yeah, they don't know what they're flying into.
Well, they're termites. How smart can they be? But they're hungry.
Yep.
But let's talk about that, because they swarm in summer. You know, they come out and what are some of the? How long does it take before a swarm would affect my house? If there's a big swarm in my neighborhood, that means I'm getting when am I going to start to be able to see what damage they might be doing?
So there's two answers to that question. The first one is drywood termites.
Mm-hmm.
Drywood termites typically have much smaller colonies and they breed slower.
Okay.
So drywood termites, a king and a queen, will land in your house, and the first thing they're going to do is find a little crack and start having babies and laying eggs and having baby termites. It takes about between 3 to 5 years to see any noticeable evidence of that infestation. I'm not saying damage. What I'm saying is evidence.
Before you can see it.
So evidence being that you might see some little pellets being kicked out of a hole. And that's pretty minor. There's probably no significant damage at all, no structural damage. It's just that there's evidence. But that is the time at which you should fumigate your house. Mm-hmm. When you see evidence, it's time to start doing something.
I heard one lady say, I just sweep it up all the time. You know, you
can do that. It's like the ostrich in Africa, sticking his head in the sand when the lion's coming, so it can't see the lion. And it doesn't work out too good.
Yeah.
So that's the first question. So that's drywall termites. The second one is subterranean termites. So subterranean termites, they have much larger colonies. And so the damage caused by subterranean termites can be substantial, because not only can they start new colonies in your house, because if they land in an area where there's moisture, for example, water trapped in a gutter, they can start an above ground nest, but they also come to your house through the ground.
So you have
this giant colony that might have 20 million termites in it that's living under your neighbor's house, but now they find your house.
They
can cause a lot of damage quickly.
You said in the past that, you know, one of the things that we do for some is get rid of the bridges, cut back your landscaping and other stuff. But what about the ground itself? Is there anything that you can say paint around your house or put around your house as a barrier? Or
That's exactly what a termiticide treatment does.
Okay.
So liquid termiticide is applied around the foundation or around your footing blocks or whatever it might be, or your stem walls. And that is that gap you're talking about.
Okay.
And so when the termites pass through that gap, the best termiticides are actually non-repellent. They don't repel the termites.
Mm-hmm.
Because what happens is if the termites are repelled, like the old termiticides used to be, they're repelled by the termiticide. They just walk along that repellent edge
until they find a place they can get through where the
soil's been disturbed or something.
Wow.
So the non-repellent ones work best. So they'll go through. They won't cause much damage because they're social insects. What they're actually doing is they're going into your house to find food, and then they take it back. They regurgitate it through a process called trophallaxis.
Feed the family.
Yeah. Then they send out a pheromone saying, hey, there's a food source here. Go and get some food, and the other termites will follow.
What's the shelf life of that treatment? I mean, you know, how often would you do that termicide?
All depends on the type of active ingredient, but the most effective one, the one we choose to use, is Termidol. Termidol is a very good product, and the reason I'm sold on it is because we actually did the field trials for Hawaii. This goes back 18 years ago,
right? Yeah.
And we did all the field trials with them, and we did the field trials. I think I came on your show with that.
Yeah, I remember Dr. Julian Yates. Yeah,
we
met this guy. He was an entomologist with the state, Dr. Julian Yates. What a guy.
Yeah, he's
what a super guy.
He's still in the business.
Yeah, I know. He's a terrific
I think he's
guy.
About to retire. He's an awesome guy, though.
But, you know, Michael, one of the things that I got asked after our last show when we talked about what you can do to sort of, you know, termite-proof your house a little bit. There's a lot of people that really love that information, but they don't have the ability either themselves or their family to do it. Is that something that your company does? When you have a central con treatment or something, can somebody ask, can somebody come and do some work to fix me up?
You know, in the past, we've just referred them to other people because we actually don't have a contractor's license to do construction or a handyman's license. So we typically refer that away.
I get you.
It might be something we actually do in the future because there is definitely a demand for it. But
I'm thinking that would be remedial. You know, I'm talking really about preventative.
Proactive.
We
do both. Our customers ask us both, can you fix the damage, and then what can we do to protect it? Because we'll go then, we'll say, look, you've got wood-to-ground contact. Mm-hmm. That's the most common infraction.
Wood-to-ground. Yeah.
So you have wood siding that maybe didn't start above below ground, but maybe the soil washed up against the side of the house or whatever.
Or maybe you thought you were being smart and you fertilized and you put some more topsoil in and you built up
mulch,
your garden a little
even,
bit.
Even better.
Yeah.
Now you have...
That's like a buffet, isn't it?
So now you've got that bridge. Yeah. So now you've got the termites living in the ground. They can go straight into the wood of your house, and then that's all over.
Oh, boy.
And so, you know, the building code, I believe, is 6-inch gap between wood and the grade.
Okay, six inches.
Yeah. So we always recommend to people, so have a 6-inch gap. So, for example, when your siding comes down, get a little hoe or something and hoe it away so that you get that gap. As long as there's a gap, you'll be able to see them and you'll be able to deter them. They're not going to easily go over that.
But I just had one thought, and that is that those of you that are listening and are buying into realizing that you have a need to examine and then do some prevention, if you make a good enough list, you can hire a handy person and get a pretty good rate from them, and they can do an awful lot if they know what to do. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, if you have screens that need fixing, make sure the guy's going to bring his screen kit with him instead of say, oh, I'll be right back. I got to go down and buy some screens.
And he's on the
clock. Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, if you think through the most common ways pests come into houses, of course, the obvious things like open windows. But assuming that you keep your windows, doors closed, you don't have your lights on during swarming season. So how do they get in? Well, they typically get in through plumbing pipes, like along the sides of plumbing pipes. Often there's like stress fractures or cracks in the concrete or in the wall. Maybe someone put in a new plumbing pipe, you know, cut a 3-inch hole or 2-inch hole and put in a 1-inch pipe. So there's a gap around it and that hasn't been sealed up. So it's those little areas around pipe penetrations that haven't been sealed up.
I'll bet you that the typical house that where they haven't looked after this could have dozens or more of opportunities.
Yeah, and often if they've got one, everything else is the same. So every single pipe will be the same way. Mm-hmm. The worst one is where your wood siding comes down to your concrete slab, like say on a monolithic slab. There should be some caulk that goes underneath to seal that up. That's how centipedes get in houses.
They're
crawling around. They come up. They see this nice dark little crack underneath the siding. They go up, and now they're inside your wall right behind your head when you're sleeping. They walk up, and they climb through a hole in the wall.
You know, I think the minute you say that word, that everybody starts really paying attention to the program, you know, because it is the scary guy that we have.
Yeah, no, it's a terrible insect.
Yeah. Yeah,
you know, a lot of people get bit by them.
Yeah.
And some people live in...
And he's speaking from experience. I've not had the pleasure. I've certainly been threatened. And boy, I'll tell you something. Well, I saw one a couple weeks after we did a program on centipedes a while back, and I swear it was chasing me. I swear it was chasing me in the yard. It was so fast.
Yeah,
they're surprising.
Yeah, they're aggressive. I mean, what that is basically it's just aggressive.
They're going to come and attack you.
But, you know, you're talking about bites. So do you know that rats... in America, bite 45,000 people per year.
Jeez. How crazy is that? Where do you come up with this stuff? That's scary.
This is all from the National Pest Management Association, their PPMA branch, which basically does ongoing research. And more than 500,000 people enter hospital emergency years every year suffering from insect stings.
Now, isn't it interesting that a bite is way worse than the bite? I mean, the disease that these animals have when they bite you and puncture your skin, there's stuff going into your bloodstream that is really bad.
Malaria being a classic example, or dengue fever or something like that.
Yeah, we thought that was all gone,
sleeping sickness, the tropical diseases transmitted by especially diptera, the flying insect, flies and mosquitoes are really bad. But here's another interesting statistic. And between 40 and 150 people per year in America die from insect bites and stings.
Insect bites.
In America.
There was this very interesting thing on TV the other night. I thought about you, and I'm going to record it and give it to you. It was about anaphylactic shock that people get from bee stings, and particularly those of us that are hunting or fishing or riding motorcycles or doing these crazy things outdoors. And if you don't have that kit with you, it can be life-threatening.
Yeah.
That's
know how to use the kit. It's one thing to have the kit. It's another thing to know how to use it too. And make sure that it hasn't expired. You know, in a recent survey done by some real estate association, 93% of the issues with the home were pest-related.
That is amazing.
So people that were asked, you know, how did everything go with your home? 93% of the issues were related to pest issues, termites, rats, roaches, ants, whatever it might be.
Okay, well, what about this? I failed to ask you about this in the early part of the program when we do the kind of calls you get. And I do know the last couple of weeks have been pretty busy for bed bugs. And this is, I guess, the scariest new thing. When I was a kid, nobody talked about bed bugs. I mean, they were there. Yeah. But right now, it seems like maybe because we travel so much or they're, you know, or something. But it just seems like you don't even want to even think about buying a used mattress from anybody ever.
Don't buy one. And if you do buy one, we have a service where we pick up.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Talk about that for a minute.
Yeah. So basically, we've actually reclaimed a bunch of really high-quality mattresses from hotels, and we give them away to homes and things like that. Yeah. We've given away probably 3 or 4 truckloads. And so hotels will – some of them have a policy where if they have a bed bug infestation, they will remove the mattress.
Yeah,
so you're talking about a $1,500 mattress that they take out and they throw away.
Yeah.
So we got these mattresses, and we pick them up. We have a fumigation chamber. We'll take them. We'll fumigate them in our chamber and give them away. And then
one thing I do know, gang, if you're in Michael Botha's a chamber, get out, because it's going to get everything that's in there. Everything.
Yeah, nothing survives.
Please, at the same time, explain to people if they have an antique desk or a hutch or something, how they can get it into that thing and get it fumigated.
Yeah, so we have a pickup and delivery service. Yeah. We have like a giant box van with a loading. It's a 1,500-pound loading gate on the back of it. Mm-hmm. And let's say, for example, Mike, you had some Koa furniture that needed to be fumigated. We can go down with that truck, pick it up, take it to our chamber, put it inside the chamber, fumigate it overnight, put it back on the truck, load it, and deliver it. And so we do that for everything, from doors to bedbug-infested clothing. We get ships that come in.
So that's what you do with the mattress, the same thing? It goes in there and gets...
Same thing.
Yeah.
And basically, with the mattresses, one thing I should mention is that if you are going to buy a used mattress or use one, make sure that you have a bed bug encasement. So we actually have our own brand that we sell. And bed bug encased mattress and box spring encasements are basically bite-proof encasements.
Do they stay on
long-wearing mattress? Encasements that permanently stay on the mattress.
Oh,
and so they're great. So most of the jobs that we do for bed bugs, we actually provide them at no additional charge.
Wouldn't this be something down the road that hotels would be looking at?
Oh, they do. Yeah, Many of them use them right now. In fact, that's our biggest market.
Makes no sense not to, doesn't it?
Yeah. We sell more of those to hotels than anywhere else.
Boy.
So, no, that's a very good thing to do. But in terms of how do you keep bed bugs out of your house? Well, any used furniture needs to be thoroughly checked.
Yeah.
Thoroughly checked. I would not allow any used furniture into my house without it getting treated. Simple as that. Unless it's like wooden furniture where you can inspect everything. But if it's a type of furniture with upholstery on it, or cushions on it.
Very good point, because you know, when you say furniture, you think, how could a Koa desk be a problem? Well, it can be.
It can be, but you can inspect it. Yeah, you can see it.
But that nice, that old-fashioned settee with that beautiful, you know, paste, you know, upholstery on it might be a big problem.
You know, some of the saddest stories, often people that are picking up used furniture, sometimes they just see it on the side of the road and pick it up.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the types of people who can't afford to bed bug treatments, because bed bug treatments are quite expensive. And so the people, that's why bed bugs have got so bad, because they affect the very people that can't afford the treatment. The worst situations are the locations where they can't afford the treatments. So now they've got bed bugs. What do? They don't want to tell their landlord, because they know the landlord's going to say you're responsible for it, because most leases say that the tenant's responsible for paying for a bed bug treatment.
You know, we've seen lately how some of the homeless shelters and stuff have had problems because of that very issue. And you say that, you know, you've gone ahead and given some of these things away. Is there any DIY way to do this? I mean, if somebody's, I don't want to say sees a curb alert and goes and picks up that couch because they need a couch, and what are they going to do?
The only thing you can do is get educated. There's so much information online. I would get as educated as possible. But in terms of trying to treat it yourself, absolutely not. The worst cases of pesticide abuse have involved bed bugs. So we've had people set fires. I mean, all sorts of things. People dousing their clothes in gasoline. You know, people do some crazy things.
Yeah, right? I should say a lot of and old wives' tales out there.
Yeah, so I definitely would. Because what happens is you'll try to do it yourself. You're going to fail. So what do? If a little bit didn't work, what are you going to do? You're going to add a little bit more. And then when that doesn't work, you need to combine five different ingredients.
Oh, yeah.
And so that's how these problems happen.
A chemical cocktail. Watch out.
That's
okay. When we come back, we're going to talk about that very thing. And that is what you're going to do about what are you going to do? What do you need to know about what kind of fumigation is going to be recommended for the problem that you're having in your home? It's all about prevention, and it's also about treatment.
At Sandwich Isle, we believe the best way to protect your home from unwanted pests is not through control, but through prevention. Pest prevention is a unique concept perfected by Sandwich Isle in 1997. Over the years, we have continued to improve our service effectiveness with the many technological advances in our industry. Today, Sandwich Isle's pest prevention is recognized as one of the most environmentally responsible and effective approaches in the industry. Expect more and get it with Sandwich Isle Pest Solutions. Simply put, if we cannot solve your pest problem, we'll keep coming back at no additional cost until you are completely satisfied. And if, for any reason, you're not completely satisfied, we'll refund your last payment, no questions asked. Remember, pests can no longer be considered simply a nuisance. Keeping pests out of your home is critical for your health and the health of your family. Don't settle for anything less than the best. That's Sandwich Isle Pest Solutions. Expect more and get it.
Okay, so as we get to this part of the program every week, I like it. And that, what do you need to know about fumigation? Assuming that you're like all of us, at some point in time, you are going to need fumigation. What do you need to know about it, and what do you need to feel comfortable? And more importantly, Michael, how can people prepare their home once a fumigation is going to be applied?
Well, I'll tell you what. There's so many different steps. I think we should start with what is the actual fumigation process. So, mm-hmm. And then you can think about how you're going to prepare for it. So when you tent fumigate a structure, basically you're putting a giant gas-proof tarpaulin mm-hmm. over the structure.
Big old bag, yep.
So enveloping the entire structure and sealing to the ground. So everything living has to be out of the house because it's going to be dead after the fumigation. That includes any type of pet or plant. Mm-hmm. And so fish, sometimes people have koi ponds.
Yeah.
Those koi have got to go. You can't keep them inside because they will die. Any type of plant. Sometimes people have really
big plants.
By the way,
sometimes those koi cost more than kids. They're very expensive, some of them. Yeah, glad you told me.
I've had to buy a few of those koi.
Yeah. Yeah.
We always tell people to move them.
Good, you know?
Yeah, so, well, we actually had a situation where we the customer said, look, don't worry about it. I can't move the koi. They're all going to die if I move them. Mm. Go ahead and do the best to fumigate it, and we'll duct
hope
in air
best.
And all sorts of things.
Yeah.
So they all died, and we ended up buying them all.
Yeah.
And so, anyway, the story changed after the job. So anything living must be removed, including plants. And then that goes for the outside of your structure too. The area about 2 feet away from the foundation of the structure is going to have the tent all like bagged up together with mm-hmm. sand snakes or water snakes, which are these basically weights to hold the thing down. So that takes up at least a 2 foot area. So any plants within 2 feet of the foundation are going to die. They're mm-hmm. either going to get crushed by the weight of the tarpaulin
right.
or they're going to die from the gas that seeps out, because a little bit of the gas will seep
sure.
out the bottom. So that needs to be cleared. Any branches, bushes, or things touching the side of the structure or on the roof, those have to be taken off too, because the tent has to
you
go. You
got to get your tent underneath it.
Underneath it.
And,
exactly.
and by the way, that can be challenging, I bet. I mean, I bet you sometimes people didn't realize in order to do that, they're going to have to, a tree's going to have to go.
Yeah, absolutely. And so that's, and sometimes it's a terrible thing for people to cut their tree. And I understand it, because I hate the thought of cutting the tree too, cutting trees down too. But that has to happen if you want to have a proper seal. The other issue was, like we spoke earlier about in Kona, the big challenge being that there's a, very hard to seal on the gravel.
Mm-hmm.
If you have gravel, some people have got some beautiful ornamental gravels, different color stones and rocks and things. You have to rake those away so that the tent has a perfect seal with the ground. And then,
that's a great point.
And then saturate that with a hose pipe before we get there.
Mm-hmm.
So the day before we get there, we want our clients to hose down and water down all the areas where the tent's going to join
mm-hmm.
the ground. And the reason for that is because gas does not go through liquid.
Yep.
So that will
nice
make it
seal.
A perfect seal. So it'll be a more effective fumigation.
Yeah, and you know, there's miles and miles to learn about this. And one of the things that you need to know is that there's some remedies, and we've talked about these in the past. I mean, in a lot of these stores you talked about, you can buy little spray cans. It has a little nozzle on them, and people actually think that they're treating their home for termites, and that's all they need to do.
Yeah, you can't. I mean, what you're talking about is those release insecticides where you break the thing. Well. Those things are not good for anything
mm-hmm.
except for starting fires. And so,
yeah, and also there's a little can that has that little straw thing on it that people squirt into their lungs.
Yeah, I've seen that stuff. And actually, that's not a bad solution if you've only got one colony of termites.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
For example, let's say you have a chair that you can pick the chair up and move it around,
mm-hmm.
and you can see there's no termites coming out the bottom of it. So
right.
all the termites are inside one piece of that chair. So now you know that if you can inject any insecticide into that one area, you'll mm-hmm. kill them all.
Yeah.
In that case, that little device you talked about drilling in fact, you could use a hairdryer, you could squirt after aftershave and then you name it.
What little word of wisdom do you want to have for people to say, oh, Michael, don't worry, termites don't eat coal?
Well,
I got living proof that they do.
You've been a customer of mine, and I have a canoe that had one. So I mean,
we
both know that doesn't
okay,
hold water.
You know, one of the things that we love to leave you with every week is a couple of thoughts. And we want you to go to sandwichisle.com for sure. But in the meantime, Michael, we reiterated earlier, there's a couple of kinds of houses in Hawaii, and we're living in both of them.
Yeah, there's two types of houses, those with termites and those that will get termites.
Yeah, and so what you going to do? What are you
basically
gonna do?
Schedule an inspection. If you haven't scheduled your inspection annually, that's the first thing you have to do.
And the best way to do that is to call 456-7716, 456-7716, or more people now are hooking up with you online.
That's right. So sandwichisle.com.
S-A-N-D-W-I-C-H, not sandwichisle.com. And you know what? The mantra is, you expect more, and by golly, you get it. Hey, thanks, Michael. See you next time.
Thank you, Mike.
Our show for today. Thanks for listening. We'll see you next time. And if something is bugging you, jump online and get the bug at sandwichisle.com. That's sandwichisle.com.